What would you do to get out of a life you hate? What would it take?
Thank you for clicking on this video. I'm Brooke Makenna, but today we are going to be talking about a man named Lawrence Batter. This is one of the most interesting missing persons cases that I have ever researched. And just because it seems solved, there are so many unanswered questions to this day, and that is why I wanted to tell you guys about it and hear your theories down below. It is such an interesting story. By the way, I am doing Suspect Summer all summer long, posting so much content. So if you are interested in content like this, please subscribe. I would love to have you here. And if you want to make me smile, you can thumbs up this video. It always brightens my day, it really does. And let's get back to the story. So Lawrence Joseph Batter was born December 2nd of 1926, and he attended St. Vincent High School. He actually didn't graduate right away. He entered the Army and during World War II, and then when he returned is when he graduated. So he was from a very wealthy family and didn't really know the proper work ethic. When he started his first semester at college, he actually had a hamburger stand that he was working on as well, and instead of going to his classes, he wanted to just hang out at this hamburger stand. But that didn't support the lifestyle that he had been used to, and he started really struggling in his life with getting the amount of money that he thought he was entitled to. But at 30, he'd kind of settled down a little bit. He was a cookware salesman at a company named Reynolds Metals Corporation, and he had a pregnant wife, and he also had three children who were 2, 3, and 4 at the time. They had a little house in Akron, Ohio, and were doing pretty well. Behind it all, they were $20,000 in debt, which is so much money back then, and were basically in trouble with the IRS. There are many people struggle with this all of the time, many people, many families, but the Batters just tried to go about their normal life and work and get back on track, but that is a very hard thing to do when you're already so far in debt. But on March 15th of 1957, Lawrence decided he wanted to take a little break and go fishing. He kissed his pregnant wife goodbye. He went down where you could rent boats at Rocky River. He got one, it was a 14-foot boat, and he decided to go down Lake Erie. It is unknown whether he had heard about the storm warnings or the choppy waves when he started out on his journey, but he did not return that night or the next morning. But the storm had passed, and the U.S. Coast Guard actually found a boat washed up on Perkins Beach in Lakewood, which was about 45 minutes from where Lawrence started his journey. Upon further investigation, they found that this boat was the one that Lawrence rented the previous day, and he was completely out of gas, and the outboard motor propeller was bent. Now, there was a scrape on the outside of the boat that looked to be from a submerged rock that it had run into, and the inside of the boat was just as much of a mess. There were water everywhere, there was fishing and tackle, and everything that you could possibly imagine to be on a boat was scattered on the floor, including the only two life jackets. One of the oars was locked into its right place, but the other one was missing, just like Lawrence Batter. So the search began for a husband and father of four children, and they searched the lake relentlessly, but found no trace of Lawrence Batter. The rescuers said that in 24 hours, without a life jacket, nobody could survive that rough water, but they also weren't surprised that they didn't find his body either. Apparently, drowning victims could easily disappear in such a big lake and vanish completely, and there was no foul play found on board, so they thought possibly he got thrown off the side when the storm hit and a wave crashed into him and he drowned and disappeared. They really looked into his background and found that he was in trouble with the IRS, and also that he had earned around $10,000 a year and did not file any taxes for 6 years previous to him going missing. But eventually, they didn't find anything that they could necessarily say it was foul play in his part, and so in 1960, he was pronounced officially dead, and his family got his $40,000 life insurance policy. You're thinking $40,000, that's a good chunk, but not too crazy. That's $400,000, around that amount, in today's time. which is a ton. But that's what his family of five needed, because he was no longer with them. So they went on to live their life normally, and as normal as they could without their father. And they thought that that was that, that they would never see Lawrence Batter again. 5 years later, the unbelievable happened. They saw Lawrence Batter standing in front of them once again. But they weren't the first ones to find him. In February of 1965, a family friend of theirs actually was at a sports show in Chicago and was walking past an archery booth where he took a second glance at the man that he had just passed. This man was wearing an eye patch, he had a mustache, but that was not the reason that this family friend took a second glance. He looked exactly like the man who was supposedly dead, Lawrence Batter. Of course, he walked right over to him and asked him if he was Lawrence Batter, if he knew anything about this. He looked just like him, and this man completely denied it all. He said his name was John Fritz Johnson of Omaha, Nebraska, and that he was a TV personality. He said he knew nothing of Lawrence Batter, but said he was one of 22 of the babies left on a doorstep to an orphanage in Boston, Massachusetts. He also said that he served around the same time as Lawrence Batter in the army, but he was discharged the year that Lawrence went missing. And he was also a married father. He had married Nancy Zimmer a few years prior. He adopted her daughter, and then they had a son together. But the resemblance was so uncanny that this family friend brought over a 21-year-old named Susanna Pekka, who was Lawrence Batter's niece. And as soon as she looked at him, she said, "Pardon me, aren't you my uncle who disappeared 7 years ago?" And John Fritz, the man in front of her with a mustache and an eye patch, just laughed and kind of shook it off and said no. But Susanna was certain at this point, and she decided to call Lawrence Batter's brothers, who were still currently back in Akron. Lawrence's brothers spoke to this lookalike on the phone and instantly booked their flight tickets. They said that the voice alone was enough to make them feel like this was their brother. But they weren't sure yet, and this man was still convinced that he was not Lawrence Batter. When they got there, John Fritz, looking at these two men, still was certain that he was not their brother. But he was also not opposed to answering any questions. Like, he wasn't hiding anything. He just didn't know. But upon answering these questions, Lawrence Batter's family got an idea of what this man had been doing while Lawrence Batter was missing. He had actually appeared in Omaha 5 days after Lawrence Batter disappeared. He started working at a bartending after he had kind of had some conversation at a round table there, and everybody loved his personality. And then he went on to work at a radio station at KBON, and there he actually sat on a flagpole for 30 days just to raise money for polio. 2 years after Lawrence Batter was pronounced dead, he had married Nancy. And then a year after that, he actually got an announcer position on TV at KETV for sports and news. He was even promoted to sports director at the TV station, and he won 13 titles in archery in that time, which was another coincidence, if you can call it, because Lawrence Batter was amazing at archery. A year after that, he had actually lost his right eye to cancer, and that is why he was currently wearing a patch. At this point, Lawrence's brothers knew that this was their brother, but they still needed to persuade him. They decided to ask him if they could possibly test his fingerprints to the ones that Lawrence Batter had given to the military when he was serving. John Fritz said yes, because he just wanted these people to leave him alone. The FBI confirmed that John Fritz Johnson was Lawrence Batter. This was to John's complete and utter shock, and he even said, "I was sure the fingerprint check would clear me. Wouldn't I be out of my mind to agree to a check if I knew I was Batter?" But when his first wife, Mary Lou, the one with four children back home, discovered that her husband, her dead husband, was still alive, and she was no longer a widow, she was, of course, very happy by this news, But that was until she found out that the $39,500 she had spent of the $40,000 now had to be paid back. And the proposal she had just accepted from another man could not go through because her marriage was officially reinstated. For 10 days, Lawrence, John, whatever you want to call him, was examined by psychiatrists, which all confirmed that he did not know of his former life. Now this man, who is thought to have been a missing person, really was found to just have lost his mind. Some believe that the tumor in his eye actually caused that memory loss, and that he knew who he was before, and he knew that he had gone missing, but nobody knows. After that, he was actually fired from his job. His wife, Nancy, told him she needed some time, and so he moved into a local YMCA and got a job back bartending. In August of that same year, Mary drove to Chicago, where she picked Lawrence, John, up by train and decided to have a little family reunion. Lawrence was so good with the kids, like he had known them his whole life, like he was their father, but he still said he did not recognize them. So John Fritz was not against being Lawrence's batter, but he also had no idea how to handle it because he said he had 30 years worth of memories of John Fritz's past. And he had no idea what to do with them, especially the fact that people were now telling him that all of those memories were false. The next year, he had stomach pains that led him to the hospital where he found out he had cancer, and the man with two identities died on September 16th of 1966. Lawrence Batter and John Fritz Johnson went to the grave without us knowing if he was the greatest liar of all time or a man with a brain that erased his entire past and replaced it with a new one. So what do you think happened to this man? Do you think that he was an innocent man who got amnesia and really does not remember anything that happened after his boat accident? Or do you think he was a smart man who knew the perfect escape to a life he hated? I want to hear your theories down below. I have no idea. A part of me wants to say that it was just a scam the whole time, and once he was caught, he thought the only reason I can say that I did this is because I don't remember my past. Because he left four children and his wife, and now had a new wife. But wouldn't it be hard to fool 10 psychiatrists into thinking that you really didn't remember anything? I don't know. Overall, this seems a lot like my Agatha Christie case where she got amnesia after hating her life as well. I don't know, crazy case. You guys let me know what you think down below. And please give me a thumbs up and subscribe if you are ready for Suspect Summer. I'm so excited for you guys, and I hope you keep coming back and listening to me and enjoying my content. So I'll let you guys go. Bye.
Too many of us want to disappear, but I promise there are other answers, my dear.